WHAV. You'll learn creative ways to grow your own vegetables and herbs while beautifying your landscape. Eco-friendly lawn care, flower garden design basics, unique container gardens, attracting birds and butterflies to the landscape, and much more. Again, please join me weekday mornings for Melinda's Garden Moment for a very environmentally friendly approach to gardening. Remember, only local radio can bring you this feature opportunity, but only WHAV does.
Wave weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre with Wave Weather. We'll head through the nighttime hours with mostly clear skies at a low temperature bottoming out somewhere in the mid-50s. Great weather for the rest of the work week. Strong high pressure in place. Mostly sunny on Tuesday with a high right around or maybe a little above 80. All clear Tuesday night. Low settling back to 60. Sunny on Wednesday with a high near 80 and mostly sunny Thursday and Friday and highs both days somewhere between 80 and 85 degrees. I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre. Your next Wave Weather in 30 minutes.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Open Mic Show. I'm Tim Coco. DJ Chris is producing in master control. Largely open lines tonight, 978-374-1900. A couple of topics, though, to perhaps tease the discussion. Quite a bit of news on Merrimack Street again this week. As you know, the Harbor Place project, $68 million project, is underway, but there have been a couple of wrinkles. There's one building that they have not been able to purchase. Most people know it as the Leahy Behavioral Health Building, known by many other names long before that. And that building is sort of an island sitting there with construction on either side of it. Now, there's one other building there that's Angel Care, and we think there's a resolution to that. Smiley School will become their new home down the road. The Greater Haverhill Foundation has entered into an agreement to purchase the Smiley School off Main Street, and that'll clear the way for another building. But there's still this nitpicky little problem of 60 Merrimack Street. And the owners of that building, who live in Boxford, have been rather quiet about it. But clearly, if you look at the deed, they spent a lot of money for that building. And Leahy is moving out, as it turns out. Leahy says it's because of development, but the owners have said nothing. And the city is going before the city council tomorrow and asking for some money to study the idea about whether to take the building, just take it by eminent domain, something we have not seen since the days of urban renewal. So that's a little teaser. That might be a good discussion. What would you do about Merrimack Street? You know, this is the shoulda, coulda, wouldas tonight. We should have done this. We would have done this. We could have done this. Let me know what you think about Merrimack Street. And this is actually quite timely. I'll throw in one more thing before we go through the routine. Noah Koretz, who's been on this program before, he's from the state. He's from Mass Development, and he's offering advice to the city of Haverhill and kind of looking at where things are going with this downtown project. And he is going to be having a forum, sponsoring a forum called a Public Charrette and Visioning Session. Public Charrette and Visioning Session. That's going to be Tuesday, September 22nd, 5 to 7 at 90 Washington Street, first floor. That's that building near the tap. So why don't we get a head start on it? Noah wants to know what you think about downtown and what the vision would be. So let's do that. But before we do that, you can watch and listen to this program at whav.tv on your computer or smartphone. You can also watch for the next 2 hours on HC Media, Channel 22 in Haverhill. Our thanks go out to the board, staff, management, and members of Haverhill Community Television for bringing the open mic show to those without internet access. Of course, you can listen to WHAV 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at whav.net, again on your computer or smartphone. You can listen on AM radio 1640. And you know, AM radio can sound pretty good if you have an old radio, because newer ones, they've kind of cut down on the fidelity to try to solve some of the interference issues. But an old radio, you might have a good chance of listening. But of course, coming soon, hopefully, with your help, your contributions, 97.9 FM, that's been licensed by the FCC, and it's just a matter of resolving some issues about putting up the antenna. But, of course, other friends in cable television across the Merrimack Valley, you can listen from time to time on Andover Channel 8, Methuen Channels 8 and 22 on Comcast, Channel 32 on Verizon Fios, Plasto Channels 17 and 23, Sandown Channel 17. Now we're going to be taking October birthdays and anniversaries this week, beginning this week, and for the LBD Second Generation Italian Bakery Cake Giveaway. Long name for a really delicious cake, 7-inch cake donated by LBD's at 140 South Main Street in Bradford. Your choice of vanilla or chocolate, all come with sugar frosting, and really a great treat. So all you have to do is wish someone a happy birthday or a couple a happy anniversary, call me on the air, and we'll enter their name into the contest. Again, 978-374-1900 to do that. Don't have to wait for a lull in the conversation. Call anytime tonight. Now, if you are shy, you can't win a prize this way, but if you want to comment on any topics, you can use the message board below the TV screen at whav.tv and type in your comment right there. We'll try to monitor it. And then if you really want to make sure you get to me, you can email me directly, tcoco, at whav.net. Now, you might have just heard a little ding here. Maybe our producer can look into this. I'm told the audio on Channel 22 is, quote, absolutely unbearable, distorted beyond belief. So perhaps it's just a matter of them turning down their input. Sounds like it's just distorted. So, folks, those of you watching on Channel 22, Chris, our producer, is going to call the station and see if they can't make some adjustments to their equipment to see if they can solve the distortion problem. Thank you, WHAV listener and viewer, for alerting us to that. All right. We also have some other prizes. For the next few weeks, Whittier Birthplace remains open. And the first caller, and I know we owe a couple of you these already, and they'll be going out soon, but the first caller who requests it can visit Whittier Birthplace, absolutely free of charge, in Haverhill. And as an added bonus, use this card to get free admission to Whittier's Amesbury home. That's a twofer. Whittier Birthplace in Haverhill, Whittier Home Museum in Amesbury. For adults, it's a $5 value at Whittier Birthplace alone. So, and this is a great time to go. Temperatures are, unlike last week, temperatures are a little more comfortable this time of year. Soon the leaves will be changing, but you can see the great landscape, 70 acres of land there. There are cows at the Whittier Birthplace. It was a farm, after all, for 326 years, going back to Whittier's ancestors, even, who built the house in 1688. Now, There's some other good reasons. If you're a member of the Greater Haverhill Chamber of Commerce, there's a trolley tour soon that'll take you to several historic sites, including Whittier Birthplace, but also including a Tattersall Farm, and we're going to talk about them in a second, and the Firefighting Museum on Canosa Avenue, Buttonwoods Museum off Water Street, and who am I forgetting? Winnie Kenny Castle, also up off Canosa. So if you're a member of the chamber, and if you're not, I think there may be a non-member rate, check out haverhillchamber.com, and you can take this trolley tour to all of these so-called treasures. So that might be something for you as well. Now, Tattersall Farm Day is next Sunday, a week from yesterday, with a rain date of the 27th. But on the 20th, WHAB will be present. WHAB will have a table there. You can pick up photographs of Tom Bergeron at the table. Of course, he's requesting you make a donation, but you can take the brochure, and it'll help with building the new 97.9 FM WHAV. All right. I think we've done most of our housekeeping. Now, I have, I guess in commemoration, and some people would say it's a memorial to baseball season this year, and we don't really have any criteria. So I guess if you call and have something very interesting to say or a very interesting comment to add, you may be able to win some of these baseball cards donated. They're all in the original packaging, donated by our friends at Kimball Tavern Antiques, corner of Salem and South Main Streets in Bradford. So here's one, 1988 Topps Major League Baseball, the real one, it says. 15 bubblegum cards and one stick of bubblegum. Now, I know Jerry in Methuen won one of these in the last few weeks, and he told me on the phone that he was not willing to chew 25-year-old or 30-year-old bubblegum. Probably a good idea. But the cards, you never know what's in there, maybe something valuable. We also have a complete collector set, Young Superstars of Baseball, 33 super gloss photo cards. And let's see, I think it has some names here. Anyone here that we would recognize? Oh, plenty here, but I'm not going to tease that too much. And then we have 1986 highlights, 1986 highlights, baseball puzzle and cards. So that's a different one. So we're going to, so it contains a Hank Aaron puzzle and 56 cards. I would say that's kind of our big bonus, 1986 highlights. So really all you have to do is call and have some interesting comments or commentary, and we'll kind of figure out how to divvy those up. So that's fine. Speaking of Jerry in Methuen, he's the show's environmental consultant. He left a message earlier that he went to a forum and was frankly surprised by whom he did not see there. He did not see certain public officials and had some concerns. Perhaps Jerry will call and share that information. In fact, Jerry has called. He is on the phone. So. All right. Jerry, you are on the open mic show.
Hello, Tim. How are you?
I got your message earlier. Sorry I couldn't pick up then, but it sounds pretty interesting. I guess you just heard me tease your call. You said that you were mostly surprised by who wasn't in attendance.
Yeah.
What forum did you attend?
The opiate forum at the senior center in Methuen.
Oh, that's right. The Merrimack Valley Substance Abuse Project.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. It was well attended. It was well attended, and you know me, I always ask the tough questions, huh? I have a fault also, Tim. Most of the time, I know what the answer is. So.
Oh. Actually, that's the best way to ask a question, right?
Yeah. But you know, it's if you want to get something out that's really lacking, then, and you know about it, and you do a lot of research, you know, spend a lot of time writing letters and and things like that. And then when you get an opportunity to ask that question to the politicians that are, you know, making the legislation, you know, for the Commonwealth about this situation, you want to ask the good question. And the good question was, the answers I was getting from the stage were, well, we've increased this by 10%. They were talking about programs, education, you know. And all of those things, programs are very, very good. But if you're going to treat opioids as a disease, then you can't forget bed space. In other words, you know, psychotherapy, bed space, and aftercare. And that wasn't mentioned until I mentioned it. You know, the question I asked was, I said, where is the basis? What is the bottom number on these particular programs that you're talking about in the new legislation is going to be funded, you know?
Right.
And I couldn't get the particular person danced, as usual, you know, and said that if I called her, on my cell phone, but...
I'm sorry, this was one of the panelists?
Pardon?
This was a panelist who wouldn't answer?
Yeah, panelist, yeah. Well, she answered, but it was, we've increased it by 10%, 15%. In other words, what I wanted to know was the bottom line, and the bottom line I know is that these programs were not funded properly. And just a simple example is the medical examiner, who is so important in this process. That program, that division, has been level funded for 12 years.
Okay.
In other words, not one increase in staff, and they're 500 cases behind, you know, as a result of that debacle at the criminal laboratory.
That's the one where evidence was contaminated and
contaminated, used, and you say it. And a number of things, you know. In fact, it put a bad name on the laboratory, and they're having problems hiring chemists. What do you think of that?
No, that does, I would imagine, if you want to advance your career, you're a young person, up and coming.
Yeah, and they have a bad rep.
You can get a job elsewhere, so why go to a place with a bad reputation?
Exactly, you know.
Hey, Jerry, can you hold 1 minute? I forgot to take our break, but if you would just stay right there. No, just stay right there. I should have done this before you came on. Why don't you stay right there? We'll continue the conversation in just 1 minute. This hour, we're going to hear about this day in Massachusetts history. Then we'll be back with the Open Mic Show.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
This is listener-supported community radio, WHAV. WHAV is the Merrimack Valley's Pacifica affiliate.
Catch the wave!
The most trusted man in America, news anchor Walter Cronkite, once said, "It is absolutely essential in a democracy to have competition in the media, a lot of competition." That sentiment is one of the driving forces behind WHAV's expanded local news effort. This is News Director Dana Esmail inviting you to listen to my hourly weekday newscasts right here on WHAV. You'll also find the area's most comprehensive local news reporting at whav.net on your computer or smartphone. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
And that's the way it is.
Today is September 14th. On this day in 1715, Boston Light on Little Brewster Island was lit for the first time. The first lighthouse built in North America, the structure weathered 60 years of lightning strikes and hurricane force winds before the British Army blew it up in 1776. 7 years later, a 75-foot tower was built to replace it. The walls were 7.5 feet thick at the base, 2.5 feet thick at the top. In the 18th century, mariners were guided into the harbor by the light of tallow candles. In 1859, a powerful new lens was installed. It significantly increased the distance from which Boston Light's beacon could be seen. Today, the beam is visible 27 miles out in the Atlantic. For more about this and other Mass Moments, go online to massmoments.org. Brought to you by the Massachusetts Foundation for the Humanities.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
This hour of the Open Mic Show being brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Just one bank. Let's continue our discussion. Jerry from Methuen, you're back. The mic is yours.
Yes, I just wanted to also get in there. The important thing in baseball is that he's not all washed up at, what is he, 34, 36 or so? He's not all washed up. He hit his 500th home run the other night.
All right, yes.
Is that the was that the question?
You want to get some more baseball cards, Jerry? Is that
it? Yeah, I want to send it to the Red Sox because some of the players, a number of the players are using chewing tobacco, and that's cancerous, really. You know, but I don't know about this gum in the baseball cards. That might be that's pretty old too.
Yeah, I was just thinking, but you didn't. I think it's been more than 30 days, so you're eligible to get some cards. So,
I am.
What's that?
I am. Yeah.
Yes, and we've got plenty here. So I'm gonna. But I'll tell you what. Just in case these, because you the last time you got baseball cards, it did have a stick of bubble gum, and you told us you were not brave enough to chew it. Is that right?
No. No, I wasn't.
But because I don't know.
I can remember playing with baseball cards. You know, you'd have a wall. Isn't it amazing the things that amused us in the old days?
That's right.
You'd have a wall, and you'd take the card, and you'd kind of flip it, and the one closest to the wall would pick them all up. In one way, it was entertaining. But the other way, it introduced it introduced me to more or less gambling, you know, because you're gambling one card against four or five, you know.
Right.
So maybe.
So Jerry is telling us what not to do.
Yeah.
But no, Jerry. You know what the real sad part of that is? Is that probably today, the kids are on their couches with a smartphone that does something similar.
You're positively right. Yeah, right.
But I'll tell you what, Jerry. You've won the complete collector's set, Young Superstars of Baseball.
Yeah.
33 super gloss photo cards.
Oh,
so,
wonderful!
So I'm going to ask.
Isn't that sad, though? They said he was finished. Some news reporter, I know it wasn't you, Tim.
It wasn't
some
me.
Some news reporter said that he was all washed up. He should quit. And you know, but I noticed this year Ortiz came to play, and he was much thinner than he was last year. Even he looked in pretty good shape.
Oh, okay.
And, it was a momentous.
I'll have to learn what he's doing then.
Yeah, it was a momentous thing that he did. 500 home runs. Can you imagine? Wow.
Very good.
He does it so.
And this is after. And this is after being told he was washed up, right?
Yeah, after he was told he was washed up. Yeah.
All right. Very good.
But the important thing is the war on opioids, and I contacted Senator Flanagan. She's from Lemesay area, but with the name Flanagan and her administrative assistant being Irish. It's amazing. The Irish really have a gift of gab, I guess. Tim?
Well, I might offend someone if I agree with you. And I might offend someone if I don't agree with you.
Yeah, but anyway, I'm going to get a copy of the legislative document that's in the Senate right now, and then I'll be able to scrutinize that, because many times in the past I went before Ways and Means on legislation and the department's budget, and it was a nice thing to do, especially when the chairman one day said to me, Mr. McCall, I don't know what you're up here for, but I really like the threads. In other words, he liked the suit I had on.
Oh, okay. Jerry, tell you what, because we've just got a couple minutes left to the news. Hey, I started out by teasing your telephone conversation of earlier, but so which elected officials were present at this substance abuse forum?
A number of councilors from Methuen. A number of wannabe councilors from Methuen. The mayor wasn't there. I didn't see him anyway. And I was really hoping to see Senator O'Connor Ives, but she had a previous commitment. Representative DiSoglio was there.
She was there.
And
okay.
Linda Dean Campbell, Representative Linda Dean Campbell.
She was there.
That was the principals. There was some very good dialogue, but I wanted one more question to ask one, but I got the gong,
You were thrown out, huh?
Yeah, I got the gong,
Well, what would you have asked? That'll be our close.
What would I have asked?
If you were allowed to ask.
I would have tried to reinforce the need for bed space and aftercare treatment, that opioids, there's no sense in locking them up. It's treated like a disease, in other words. And I've talked to psychologists, psychiatrists. The program is, the program has to be a balanced program. And it's a many-faceted program, but just locking people up because they're users isn't the answer.
No, actually, that's kind of a big nationwide discussion. That
Do you know how many deaths were in Massachusetts last year, between last year and this year?
I know that our news director is compiling those, but I don't have them handy.
3,200
deaths.
Yes, as a result of opioids
nationwide.
No, I think it was could it be in Massachusetts? No, nationwide.
Yeah, but I know that we've have. I think we're in the hundreds now, and there was just that story about the boy in Plasto and
his. Yeah. Oh, that was they discussed that. It was a good forum, but it was. Political, obviously.
Right.
Getting close to election time.
All right, well, Jerry, thank you.
But it was valuable. It really was valuable.
All right. Well, I actually appreciate the report, and I'm going to remind listeners that that's yet another topic that they can raise during our Open Everything Goes night tonight. We did have...
That would be a good subject. I'd like to hear what other people
All right. Yeah,
because... It happened in our family, so... I've spent an awful lot of time, looking at it and being an advocate for, a complete program.
No, it makes sense. And actually, it's a nationwide trend now that people are beginning to wonder why we imprison so many people in the United States compared to the rest of the world. And it may very well be that what we should be doing is treating them, not imprisoning them, and I'm welcoming calls with a contrary opinion. But Jerry, thank you very much.
Locking them up not only doesn't, some of these people could have jobs, and you know, it all ends up as a dollar. It all ends up as dollars. And
all right.
So I'm a little afraid. One item that is in the bill, which is, a mandate that insurance companies provide some care for in this regard. And I don't know, with the former CEO of Blue Cross Blue Shield as governor, I don't know whether that's going to. I don't know whether that will fly or not. What do you think, Tim?
That's an interesting question. Well, the governor surprises me so far. I wouldn't say that he's ruling from the left or from the right. He's certainly not the kind of Republican you see running in the presidential race.
Exactly. Yeah, you're right.
He's a Massachusetts Republican, which means much more liberal than the national ones, at least until they run for president. Then they become arch-conservatives. But anyway, Jerry, thank you very much.
The program that is being put forth by Senator Flanagan, who's also on Ways and Means, and that's very important. We'll see what's going to happen to it. What parts will be vetoed?
We'll follow that WHAV news. But Jerry, thank you very much for reporting on this event.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, folks, we're going to go to local news with WHAV News Director Dana Esmal. Just listen carefully to the story about Merrimack Street, because I think it's a good discussion item for after the news. Also, we'll have national news. Last I heard, and Brian will be amused by this, I think Rebecca Foster is anchoring tonight for FSN. We'll have local weather, and then we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:04.
WHAV LP Haverhill. WHAV is a nonprofit community service of Public Media of New England, Incorporated.
Here's what's happening in local news. The city is considering seizing a Merrimack Street property that stands in the way of Merrimack Street redevelopment. Haverhill City Councilors will be asked Tuesday to transfer $3,500 to purchase, quote, appraisal services relative to an eminent domain proceeding for real property located at 5666 Merrimack Street, end quote. City Solicitor William D. Cox Jr. told WHAV any such taking is not necessarily related to the $68 million Harbor Place project already underway. Quote, the city is in the preliminary stages of reviewing the taking of that particular parcel, he said. Quote, it would be a public purpose. The city has an interest and it certainly fits within the waterfront district redevelopment plan. End quote. Whether the property is eventually taken and resold to developers is a matter the city is exploring, Cox said. He added there has been no discussion with the owner of the property, DR Locke LLC, managed by Douglas R. and Patricia A. Locke of Boxford. As WHAV first reported last month, Leahy Health Behavioral Services, 60 Merrimack Street, is considering moving some services next door and closing others as it leaves, quote, the building in stages to accommodate development plans. Quote, attached is an order for the transfer of $3,500 to be transferred from other budget reserves to legal consultant services, Mayor James J. Fiorentini said in a letter to the council. Quote, I recommend approval, end quote. Meanwhile, the developers of Harbor Place expect to close on the purchase of the former Smiley School, Main Street, by the end of next month. The Greater Haverhill Foundation has agreed to buy the school for $187,500 and would make it available to house Angel Care Kids Therapy Center, now at 70 Merrimack Street. More details can be found at whav.net. Groveland Police and a Federal Bureau of Investigations task force seek the public's help to identify a suspect in the robbery of a TD Bank branch Sunday morning in Groveland. According to Groveland Police Chief Robert J. Kermelowitz, a man walked into the TD Bank on Main Street, Groveland, at 11:37 a.m. Sunday, handed a note to a teller claiming he was armed with a gun and a knife and demanding money. The suspect fled southbound on School Street, Route 97, toward Georgetown with an undetermined amount of cash. No one was injured. Investigators have released surveillance photos of the robbery. The suspect is described as a black male, 20 to 30 years of age, approximately 5'11", weighing 160 to 170 pounds. He was wearing a blue Los Angeles Dodgers baseball cap with white letters and a white brim, a black hooded raincoat, blue jeans, sunglasses, and black and white tennis shoes. Anyone with information is urged to call the Groveland Police Department at 978-521-1212. All callers may remain anonymous. A weekend celebration of Haverhill's 375th anniversary, including free breakfast Sunday at Riverside Park, brought what organizers called, quote, light to, quote, good attendance levels and an estimated $21,000 net cost to taxpayers paid by a state grant. 375th Anniversary Committee Chairman and Haverhill Parks and Recreation Director Vincent Ouellette told WHAV Sunday the celebration, beginning with Thursday night's Haverhill Yesteryear Ball and ending with ethnic music performances Sunday, cost a total of up to $35,000. About $14,000 in fundraising by volunteers will be supplemented by about $21,000 from a $75,000 state grant obtained through the legislature by Representative Brian S. Dempsey, House Ways and Means Committee Chairman. Ouellette said a base audience was built for the, quote, first-time event, despite competing traditional events in area communities.
When you compete with some of the surrounding communities, such as Andover and Golden Days, we have our own Indian powwow, which we've been doing, coordinating for the last 28 years, and that's always a pretty good turnout that this weekend, as well as Hampton Beach's Chowder Fest. So when you're competing with things that have been traditionally this weekend, it does, you know, it is going to draw away until you build your own base of support. And to be honest, I really think that the people that came here, the people that enjoyed it, and the people who want to see it, would like to see it continue, that base has been formed.
A peak attendance level between 500 and 600 people came during Saturday evening's concerts and outdoor screening of the classic movie The Wizard of Oz, according to 375th Anniversary Committee member and Haverhill Historical Commission President Kerry Fitzgerald. In contrast, estimates of up to 350 people turned out Friday evening for a performance by Massachusetts native Ayla Brown. However, Ouellette added a children's activity tent was an event highlight bustling with activity. For more in-depth coverage, visit whav.net. A healthcare organization without debt and one that still beats many national patient outcome averages is seemingly rare. The Greater Lawrence Family Health Center, however, reported just such findings last week. The nonprofit released its 2015 annual report last week before a crowd of supporters and donors at Andover Country Club. In addition, according to retiring president and chief executive officer Robin Ngala, the group saved the healthcare system $58 million.
Community health centers actually save the health system $3 for every dollar that the federal government invests. That's because we're a natural alternative to very expensive emergency room care.
Quality indicators show GLFHC patient outcomes beat national Medicaid plan averages in areas such as diabetes management, weight control, disease prevention, cervical cancer screenings, and controlled blood pressure. For more details, visit whav.net. In local high school sports, Haverhill Hillies Boys Varsity Golf tees off Monday afternoon against Bill Ricker Memorial at Bill Ricker Country Club. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmail.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Rebecca Foster. Australia has a new prime minister following the ousting of Tony Abbott. Former Communications Minister Malcolm Turnbull has been elected leader of the Liberal Party in a late-night vote at Parliament House. Mr. Turnbull is generally considered less conservative than his predecessor and contrasts with Mr. Abbott in his stances on gay marriage and climate change. He will be the country's fourth prime minister since 2013. Egypt's prime minister has apologized after a dozen tourists were killed and another 10 sent to the hospital when Egyptian security forces mistook them for militants. Mexicans and Egyptians were among the victims. Egyptian officials say the holidaymakers were traveling in unmarked cars within a restricted zone in western Egypt when security forces opened fire. Andrea Arenas reports.
The tourist convoy of 4x4 vehicles had reportedly stopped for a barbecue when it was shelled by Egyptian army aircraft before troops opened fire from the ground. Mexico's foreign ministry said two of the victims and at least five of the injured were Mexican, but was still working on identifying the dead and wounded. A spokesperson for the Egyptian tourism ministry said the group did not have permits and did not inform authorities that they were heading to the area close to the border with Libya. Mexico's President Enrique Peña Nieto, who has demanded a full investigation, took to social media to condemn the attack.
Russia has positioned at least half a dozen tanks near a strategic airfield in Syria, according to Reuters reports. U.S. officials say the area where the T-90 battle tanks were seen is a stronghold for Syria's Bashar al-Assad regime, long supported by its Russian ally during the ongoing civil war. Kevin McAleese reports from Washington.
A Pentagon spokesman said the U.S. is closely monitoring the buildup, but stopped short of exact details about the numbers of Russian military personnel and hardware being flown to Latakia on the Syrian coast. The U.S. is concerned that Russia's military forces could potentially come into contact with the U.S. air campaign against ISIS in Syria. Speaking at the U.S. State Department, John Kirby said the U.S. position hasn't changed.
Well, we would welcome, and I said this last week, a constructive Russian role in countering ISIL. It can't include direct support to the Assad regime.
President Obama has already warned Moscow that doubling down on its long-standing support of the Assad regime would be a big mistake.
U.S. law enforcement anticipates it will be filing additional charges in the expanding FIFA scandal. U.S. Attorney General Loretta Lynch told reporters that the American investigation is continuing and getting broader. From bureaus worldwide, this is FSN.
Wave weather.
I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob Saint here with Wave Weather. We'll head through the nighttime hours with mostly clear skies at a low temperature bottoming out somewhere in the mid-50s. Great weather for the rest of the work week. Strong high pressure in place. Mostly sunny on Tuesday with a high right around or maybe a little above 80. All clear Tuesday night. Low settling back to 60. Sunny on Wednesday with a high near 80 and mostly sunny Thursday and Friday and highs both days somewhere between 80 and 85 degrees. I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre. Your next Wave weather in 30 minutes.
Stay informed each day with local news coupled with FSN's worldwide coverage. WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
This is Pacifica Radio for the Merrimack Valley. WHAV LP Haverhill. Listener-supported community radio.
Catch the wave, WHAV, Merrimack Valley. Open mic!
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
This is the Open Mic Show, a 50-year staple of democracy in the Merrimack Valley. This hour of Open Mic being brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Just one bank. Okay, we do have a caller on the line, and I know we have another one that's expected to call, who called during the break. But before we do that, let me just talk about a couple of things. Open lines tonight. We did have a guest scheduled, but something came up. That person couldn't arrive. So it's a good opportunity, though, because there's a couple of items in the news that maybe you want to comment on, and some items that aren't in the news yet, but you'll hear them first here on the Open Mic Show. All right. Tuesday, September 22nd, from 5 to 7 o'clock at night at 90 Washington Street. That's the building next to the TAP. There is going to be a public charrette and visioning session. Essentially, the city is looking for your opinions on what to do downtown. And I think, why don't we give them a head start? What do you think? Merrimack Street's in the news again today on WHAV exclusively, and that is before City Council tomorrow night. Councils are going to be asked to spend $3,500 to consider taking 60 Merrimack Street by eminent domain. That means they would take it and reimburse the owner at value. And as we've seen in the past, sometimes these can be fraught with problems. The old grad building, if anyone remembers that, basically where the parking garage is now on Merrimack Street, Vincent Grad did not like the amount of money he was paid for his building when it was taken during urban renewal. He sued, and it took many years, and won his case. And with all of that accrued interest, it was pretty harmful to the city budget during the 1980s. So a taking of a property is not an easy proposition. Another Merrimack Street item that will be in the news, but you hear it first here on the open mic, beginning this Wednesday, the section of Merrimack Street in front of Pawtucket Bank is going to be closed. So that means if you want to do banking with Pawtucket Bank, you're best to use Bailey Boulevard and park on the parking garage on the top and use the back entrance. But there will be... there are going to be some other alternatives, and they suggest perhaps even using another Pawtucket Bank branch at Westgate or Haverhill Stadium, or use online banking. So this Merrimack Street project is heating up. Another topic we might discuss is, did you go to Haverhill's yesteryear ball celebrating Haverhill's 375th anniversary last Thursday? Did you attend any of the events at the stadium this weekend? There were bands playing. There was a cultural festival. And if you just heard our news director, unfortunately, the weather seemed to keep people away yesterday. Maybe you have a thought on that. How many of you were stuck in the horrendous traffic jam Friday morning? We had a situation with... an accident apparently of some kind on Route 495. Now, those of you who were trying to get on the highway, maybe at Main Street or Broadway, found that you couldn't even get down the ramp. And so many cars used Route 125 as their traveling method. And downtown Haverhill jammed up rather significantly. Maybe you have a thought on that. I always wonder if maybe the people behind these traffic accidents should be fined a little extra when they inconvenience hundreds of people. I found it took me 45 minutes to get across Haverhill to get from my home near the Plasto border to the studio in Ward Hill. Maybe you've had experiences like that. Another topic we might discuss tonight is what do you think? The Greater Lawrence Family Health Center, which has six locations, five in Lawrence, one in Methuen, they are debt-free. They've served 55,000 patients, and they don't have any debt. So, you know, maybe they're doing something right. That's a topic you might want to discuss. We've heard of other healthcare institutions that just can't seem to balance their budgets. So maybe you have a thought on that. So, but let's take a break first. I apologize to the caller on the line. We'll take a break first for Community Spotlight. Then we'll be back and catch up on your calls.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
Those Boston stations don't always understand weather in the Merrimack Valley. Stay informed with Wave Weather every 30 minutes, 24 hours a day on Soft Gold WHAV.
Community Spotlight is brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Haverhill Bank is a generous supporter of the area's civic and cultural program.
That's all it takes, it's just Spotlight.
The Haverhill Council on Aging is hosting its annual craft fair, Saturday, November 14th at the Citizens Center, 10 Welcome Street, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. There is no cost for the table space, and the fair is open to all crafters 60 and over. All items must be handmade, and no flea market tables are permitted. For more information, contact Kathy Bresnahan or Rita LaBella at 978-374-2390. Someone you know is on WHAV. To submit or read your own nonprofit announcements, click on the contact tab at whav.net or email news at whav.net. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Maddie Karen.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco at whav.net.
This hour of the Open Mic Show being brought to you by Haverhill Bank. Just one bank. All right, we are taking October birthdays and anniversaries this month. Wish someone a happy birthday or a couple a happy anniversary, and you or the recipient could win a free 7-inch cake, choice of vanilla or chocolate, from our friends at LBD's Second Generation Italian Bakery, 140 South Main Street in Bradford. Let's go to the phones. You are on the Open Mic Show.
Hello, Tim.
Well, well, how are you, Brian, regular
okay,
caller?
Ready to kick off the birthdays.
All right, so who do we have for birthdays?
Well, I gave Chris three of them. I was going to space them out, but he took them all.
All right, well, he's like that, you know, very greedy.
Yeah, well, we have Lisa.
All right, Lisa.
We have Lisa. We have Courtney.
Courtney.
And we have Jerry.
Jerry, as in Geraldine?
No, as in Gerald.
Oh, my goodness. There's a guy in the group this time.
Yeah, it happens.
All right. So
the thing with Jerry is he's a neighbor, you know. He's only three doors down from me, so that's the closest chance I have to getting
a slice of cake.
Yeah.
And, you know, folks, I tell you that every week. Nominate someone who's who either, you know, lives in your house, is your neighbor next door, a coworker, and make sure that you get a slice of this delicious cake from LBD's Second Generation Italian Bakery. So Brian is hedging his bets here. Normally, he nominates only the most beautiful women in the city, but he knew that he might not get a cake from them, so he's nominating his neighbor. I hope
well,
I didn't
probably eat the whole cake and. I'll tell you, I haven't had a piece. Well, never mind that.
All right, so we don't want to misrepresent the issues here. Hey, you know, Merrimack Street's back in the news, and Brian and I want other listeners to call in about this. Apparently, folks from Mass Development working with the city of Haverhill are going to look at a vision for downtown Haverhill. Actually, this is what they said. Engage with fellow stakeholders and help to re-envision the urban design strategy for the eastern half of downtown Haverhill. So this is clearly not Washington Street, it's Merrimack, and I bet they've all forgotten that Water Street probably needs a vision of its own. But in any event, you grew up there. You watched the wrecking ball. You saw the Dust Bowl rise. Then you saw a bunch of crappy buildings go in place, I'm sorry to say. And then we saw a bunch of missed opportunities, like widening the street because we didn't take down, you know, one side completely. So we're still going to be stuck with a narrow street no matter what we do. And now that I prefaced all the bad news, what would your vision for the eastern part of downtown be?
Well, eastern part. You know, I remember the simple days when we just talked about putting a roof on top of it and making calling it a mall or something. That's kind of dead.
Yeah, there was a...
Well, I told you how I feel about downtown. I'm not impressed with that Harbor Place project. I know everybody else is, because no matter what they put down there, it's going to be an improvement. And from the beginning, I've been saying that they ought to just cut to the chase and build a tall building. It'll obstruct less view of the river. You know, it'll be better. But no, they're not going to do that. They're going to spread it out, and now they get a problem with the locks.
That's right.
That building there, you know. I didn't even know the locks owned it. Last time I looked, it was the Fishbines.
So. Oh, do you know the locks?
No, I don't know them. I just know that they have property all over Haverhill.
All right, yep. I think it's Doug and Susan Locke.
Yeah.
And of Boxford. And
I looked at some of the units when I was looking for an apartment several years ago, and that's when I bought my condo at Hunter's Rent.
Oh, all right. So they own housing?
Yep.
All right. Now, I don't know much about their other investments in Haverhill, but looking at the deeds, and I don't have the number off the top of my head, but my guess is they bought at the wrong time, at the top of the market, and now they have a building with a pretty much one whole side missing from it. I understand, talking to sources today, that I guess there was a belief that there was a strong outer wall between that building and the one that was demolished next to it. And it looks like that many things in the past here, they shared a wall. So this building is pretty much missing a side wall. That's why you see all the blue plastic on it. And I'm kind of wondering when the other shoe is going to drop. I imagine they are getting frustrated. I don't know. So it's interesting to say, or to guess. Maybe we'll hear from them. I know that the news department's been trying to get some word on what they think. Now that the city is thinking about just taking it by eminent domain, you know, that might be even a good solution for them. Because nice thing about eminent domain, if there is any nice thing about it, the nice thing about it is that maybe he's stuck with some leases or some tenants. Leahy says they're moving out over time. Maybe there are other tenants I'm unaware of, you know, upper floors or in the back or something. And, well, eminent domain erases all those. He's no longer stuck with the obligation, can get some big lump sum cash from the city. How we are going to pay for it, I don't know.
Well, I wouldn't expect that big lump sum would be all that big. I don't know.
Well,
remember the all the houses that were taken down. And what did we call it? Pentucket Urban Renewal?
The Pentucket Urban Renewal Project.
For some reason, I got the $6,000 figure in my head. And I'm sure that some of those properties were worth more than that. They're mostly owner-occupied.
No, I would think that even in the late 1960s, property was worth more than that.
Yeah.
For a dwelling unit, as they would have been called.
Well, I was just a kid, but, you know, I've heard of people that's what they were given.
All
but
right.
I couldn't really say, because...
Well, you know, there's some comments on our website. Maybe it's a good chance to tell you about some of them. One writer on WHAV.net wrote... just another day in the tyrannical states of America. What's yours is yours until government wants it for them and their friends.
Well, yeah, that's the American way.
All right. And here's another comment. We're watching an unfettered, out-of-control dictatorship play out right before our eyes. Well, I didn't think it was that bad, but let's see what this person says. They're making plans to use public funds to take property, and they have had no discussions with the property owners. Well, that's what we were told at WHAV News this morning. Any city councilor who votes in favor of this is participating in outright larceny. There is no other way to describe it. It's a lot easier to go in and steal than it is to pay market price, isn't it? Can taxman, I'm going to leave out the next word, referring to the mayor, get any, I'm going to leave out the next word. All right, so this is not a fan of the mayor, and he goes on and on and on, and maybe we'll talk more about that comment later, but...
Well, it seems to me they should have worked this out before they even started the project.
I will tell you, in general, I agree with you that anything is better than what we had. But I have said this to the people involved, and they're not happy to hear this from me. But I have said that what concerns me the most is that, okay, you're going to be doing some good things for the city. Thank you. We do appreciate it. But you're not telling us enough about your plan, how you're going to achieve it, what we might see as side effects, perhaps, or collateral damage, like the side of a building missing. I think there's an overall lack of transparency. And I think what it does is that people who would otherwise be ardent supporters are skeptical because they feel something is being kept from them. And I guess we won't know that until this whole thing plays out. But I will tell you, the WHAV News, to the chagrin of many, is going to keep asking the tough questions, keep doing the research. If you recall, it was WHAV that broke the news, and each time a piece of property was purchased, you heard about it here first on WHAV. And I think there are a lot of people who thought, well, we ought to be able to operate in secret. Why is WHAV telling people? Well, that's what we do. So, okay, that's a little bit of a rant.
Transparency, right?
Well, it just seems to me that when... Okay, here's the bottom line for me, and I don't know, you know, listeners sometimes don't like to hear negativity, so I'm going to try to put the best face on this. There is $20 million, $20 million in taxpayer money in this project, coming from the state, but that means if you pay state income tax, you paid for some of that. And you might say, hey, that's great. I want my money used to make our downtown better. Okay, that is fine. But what if we don't have some important fact? Like, maybe that 60 Merrimack Street building was so critical that the whole project is in jeopardy without it. And now we're going to have to throw some more money at this, this time coming out of the pockets of property taxpayers. And if you pay excise tax or if you pay a city fee, you're going to be paying for this. Do we have enough information? I think generally, Haverhill people would say it's worth it at almost any price to get rid of the deterioration downtown. But will they still think that when they're told next year, you know, we're going to have to go to the max with Prop 2.5, and we're going to have to raise all of the fees because we didn't plan on spending $1 million to buy a private building?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't know. So, good food for thought, and pardon my rant.
No, that's fine.
All right. Well, anyway, you got three birthdays in, and and I know you're betting on. I say you're betting on Jerry to invite you over for cake, but one of these beautiful women inviting you over might be even better, right?
Yeah, well, I haven't talked to Lisa in a while, and I hope she's not mad at me.
I can't imagine, and when she gets a piece of cake, she definitely won't be.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Brian, thanks for your call.
And remind me to fill you in on my latest meeting at the police department.
Oh, yes, let's save that for another call, and then I have to fill you in on a project you asked me about, so we'll apprise the listeners of all of that soon.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Brian.
Have a good evening.
Good evening.
Goodbye.
All right. So we have another caller we need to get on the line, but we're going to have to take a break for weather. So why don't we hear what's going on in local weather, and we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show in just a minute.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:35.
The Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom turns out local programs every day and night. Tune in for local news, community spotlight, and the Open Mic Show. WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
Catch the wave!
This is Jim Hightower, asking you to listen to my little pops of populism three times a day, right here on WHAV. Only local radio at its finest, WHAV, brings you this populous feature. So catch the wave, and you'll catch my commentaries. Thank you.
Wave weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre with wave weather. We'll head through the nighttime hours with mostly clear skies at a low temperature bottoming out somewhere in the mid-50s. Great weather for the rest of the work week. Strong high pressure in place, mostly sunny on Tuesday with a high right around or maybe a little above 80. All clear Tuesday night, low settling back to 60. Sunny on Wednesday with a high near 80 and mostly sunny Thursday and Friday, and highs both days somewhere between 80 and 85 degrees. I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre. Your next wave weather in 30 minutes.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Many thanks to the sponsor of the last hour, Haverhill Bank, Just One Bank, for bringing you the first hour of the Open Mic Show, and now the second hour of Open Mic being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. Okay, phone lines are lighting up. Let's go to the phones. You are on the Open Mic. That's you.
Hello.
Hi there. Hey, sorry to keep you waiting tonight.
That's fine, sir.
What's on your mind?
I was just sitting here and I was reading the paper, sir, and I'm a lifelong resident of Haverhill, 52 years. You know, and the city celebrated their 375th anniversary. And, you know, it's kind of a shame that the city didn't think about maybe the elderly or other people that don't have transportation. They should have offered some type of transportation for people down it, you know, so they could enjoy it.
Well, then that's a very good point. So you mean like a shuttle bus or something?
Absolutely. We have it at the Christmas stroll, you know.
Actually, very, very good point. I wonder, well, you know, there are some more events coming up. Maybe it's not too late to do that for, let's say, there's music.
The 306, my grandmother was the first dental hygienist in the city of Haverhill.
Really?
And the 375th anniversary, I mean, to me, that was foreplanned. You know, I feel bad for the elderly or the people who don't have transportation, you know?
Actually, it's a valid point. It's a valid point, and I think yesterday the city would have appreciated, especially yesterday because of the weather, to have a few more people present, and there was free breakfast.
I understand that, yeah.
And that would have been nice for some families, I bet. I mean, of course, nothing is free, as Dana points out in his newscast today. There was some state money in there and some city money, and then there was about, I think, $14,000 in private fundraising, so there is no such thing as a free breakfast either.
I can tell you that, you know, sir, I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, go right ahead.
I've contributed myself to the youth in the city of Haverhill. I coach Little League for almost 8 or 10 years and many other things. I think that if I was on this committee and I nicely went over to the transportation company over by Skateland and asked them if they'd do a favor for the city for this anniversary, I bet they would have obliged.
Actually, I think there's a lot of good reasons why they would. After all, they have a contract with the city. It's you're talking about the Merrimack Valley Regional Transit Authority.
Absolutely. I mean, Sundays, I'm not sure if they run or not, but pay a small, not the whole fee, maybe small fee, you know?
Well, they do run. I don't know if it's a complete schedule, but if it was
No, it's not, sir.
It's not. Okay, so you're familiar with it.
Yes.
So, well, I think you made an excellent point. But there are events coming up. There is the powwow at Plug Pond. There's the Haverhill Experimental Film Festival. There's Tattersall Farm Day. And then there's River Ruckus. Maybe it's not too late to think about a shuttle. And I actually, it's funny. I'm just thinking about, say, a senior citizen at the Julian Steel Project off Lowell Avenue and off Washington Street.
Do you get downtown when they have the Christmas stroller? They have that trolley that runs up and down over in Bradford.
Yeah, actually, I didn't know how far it ran, but that's good to know.
They don't charge you nothing to ride on that.
No, but I'm actually thinking if someone's out in, Bradley Brook, I don't know that it's easy for them to get downtown either.
Coppola Bus Company. I mean, I'm sure we have a great contract with them, and they would gladly offer up a couple buses for a couple workers to make some overtime.
You know, I have to tell you, there's a story here. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to tell it. You know, Nelson Blinn at Coppola Bus Company is one of the most generous, underappreciated men in this city. He stepped up last year when Kids Fest moved to Kimball Farm, at least for 1 year. Luckily, they moved back this year. He stepped up and he said he would provide free, shuttle buses, drivers, and the whole bit between downtown and Kimball Farm. Now, that's a little bit of a trek. And he was willing to do it, and so you're absolutely right. There are people in this city who are quite generous. All you have to do is ask them.
I mean, I know hundreds of people who would have enjoyed going down there, sir.
No, that's a very good point. I'm very glad you raised that. And like I said, it's perhaps not too late. Maybe for some of these other upcoming events, and I'm told a little further down the schedule, and this might be ideal for what you're discussing. I understand. Now, maybe it isn't finished yet or formal, but there might be this big New Year's Eve party. And, wouldn't that be a treat for some residents who otherwise couldn't get out?
Not only the residents, sir, the youth of the city. Because I drive around and I see these young kids standing on the street corners at night. And I say to myself, boy, times have changed. My mother used to do her whole Christmas shopping downtown Haverhill. And that's the truth.
That's right. The Northeast Shopping District, as it was called.
We had that big gold bell right in the center by the post office. I don't know whatever came of that.
That's a subject of a lot of speculation. But David Zoffoli, he's been on this program, it's been a couple of years, he had an idea to bring back, even if we had to make it all over again, to bring back the bell and the music in Washington Square and to put up all those lights and all the wreaths. I mean,
remember that as a kid. It was fantastic.
Yeah, I grew up here too, and it's like you just feel like you're in an idyllic place at the holidays. You've got all these decorations and these lights and the festivities, and you just feel better about living here.
And you want people from other cities to come in. I mean, that's something that other cities don't have, something like that.
No, and it kind of reminds me of those old movies from the 40s. We once had that look. David and Creative Haverhill parted company, but maybe it's another idea. It's not too late. We have Christmas every year. Maybe there's still time to fabricate a new bell, to get the wires up, to put the music in the square. I hope you'll call the open mic more often because you're really getting me going.
We're on the Christmas. I have one more thing I want to ask you.
Okay.
Now, it's been brought to my attention that from a retired firefighter that a fire truck from what's the name of it, down by Demoulas there, the fire engines aren't allowed over the Bazalet Bridge because there's a...
You mean the Water Street trucks?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there's a weight limit on the Bazalier?
There's a weight limit on the Bazalier, and I was told from a retired firefighter that the fire engines are no longer able to go over that bridge. They got to use the new bridge. Now,
So they're going to go through all that traffic on Merrimack and Washington Square and Washington to the Como Bridge.
We had a fire over in Forest Acres, if you don't recall.
I do, absolutely.
A young girl got seriously injured.
Devastating.
And I'm just wondering why one time a year, after all this pile, I'm into construction, so
okay.
After all this pile driving that they've done down there after the Woolworth building got wiped out, has anybody, it's already deemed unstructural for heavy trucks to go over, fire engines. Has anybody inspected that at all? And how come once a year, I don't understand, sir, we can hold a Christmas parade and every fire truck from around every city around this table goes over that bridge along with 18 wheelers. Now, is that deemed unsafe, or is that safe?
Oh, no, that's okay. That, you're bringing up a real good point, and I'm afraid I'm going to ask, and I will tell you, they'll deny it.
City Hall won't give me no answers.
They'll deny it, but every city official watches this program. Every city councilor, every school committee member, the mayor, I know it, they deny it until they rush up to me afterward and said, well, you know, your caller shouldn't have said that. I said, oh, I thought you didn't listen. So I invite anyone, any candidate for city council, any city councilor, the mayor, anyone who can either dispute what you're saying, like, oh, no, there's no restriction, or say, yes, that is a concern, and this is what we're doing about it. But yeah. You raise one very, very interesting point. I'm not sure if the listeners...
I don't mean to cut you off.
No, that's fine.
Just this afternoon, the engines come out of there, and they had to go all the way to downtown. Me and my wife were shopping, and I was heading that way, and they had to go over that new bridge. They couldn't use the one on, One Water?
Yes.
Because that bridge has been deemed unsafe. And if you walk over that, you can see that it is deteriorating.
All right. Now
with all the pile driving that's been going on, I'm sure we've hit ledge. Has anybody inspected that? The mayor once said that, geez, you know, it would be kind of nice if we went back to the old route, down by the old Bradford Fire Station, down the hill, straight across, okay, over the new bridge, and right downtown. Bring some new people into the city. Put up those Christmas lights. You know what I'm saying, sir?
Yes, I do, actually.
Go
excellent.
Right downtown and take a left at One Water and go up the hill. Because I know that that bridge is deemed unsafe because I was told by a friend. At one time, they couldn't even go in the Woolworth building because this firefighter friend of mine, boot went right through the floor. It was rotted. So if that place caught fire, it was just going to be a surround and drowned.
Okay. Excellent points. And you mentioned the pile driving. For people who aren't familiar with it, it's the foundation being driven to the ground.
Oh, yes, I understand that, sir.
Yeah, so I think,
ledge and everything that they
So I think our listeners need to know that because it's a good point you make. All right, well, I'll tell you what, we have to take a break, but I really appreciate your call. I hope we'll hear from you again because you've raised some excellent points.
Sure. I mean, I'd love to see the parade. Like you said, I'd love to see someone fabricate a bell. Give it away to your Votech metal fab. That's what I took when I was at Whittier Trade.
Okay.
Let them do a little job. Put up the Christmas lights, run it downtown, and let all these people that come from other cities come in and see downtown April.
Excellent point. Excellent point. Great suggestion about Whittier Votech, too. Well, thank you very much. Really appreciate your call.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Have a good night.
You too. All right, excellent, excellent suggestions. This is the kind of thing we like to do on the open mic. It's open lines for you to call 978-374-1900. We're going to take a brief break. This hour, we're going to hear a movie review from Take Two Movie Review, and then we'll be back with more of the open mic show.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the open mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now.
Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
This spot could have been yours. Support WHAV's local approach with your underwriting. Go to WHAV.net and click on advertising to reach thousands of new customers.
Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. They're attracted by the region's technology and innovation, housing and education, workforce, arts, culture, and recreation, and convenient location and easy access. Learn more and look at profiles of all 24 cities and towns at the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council website at merrimackvalley.info.
Open mic!
Every Monday night, the Open Mic Show brings interesting guests into your homes, presents your take on current events, and dabbles in little-known local history. I'm Tim Coco, your host, inviting you to join the chorus of community voices beginning at 6:30 Monday nights right here on WHAV. You may also watch this 50-year staple of democracy live at WHAV.tv and Haverhill Community Television, Channel 22. The Open Mic Show was brought to you by Northern Essex Community College, the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council, and WHAV members. Remember, only local radio can bring you this talk opportunity, but only WHAV does.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, at least they didn't block the exits. If you've seen what passes for drama on network TV lately, you have a pretty good idea of what the Dowdle brothers bring to the big screen. Straightforward plots, slick production, passable acting, but a product lacking in any depth. Their latest, No Escape, has the elements of a decent film. Jack Dwyer, played by Owen Wilson, along with his wife and young daughters, arrive in an unnamed Southeast Asian country where he's to be employed by a multinational corporation working on hydro infrastructure. Simultaneously, an anti-Western coup commences, which sends unidimensionally presented mobs of angry brown people into the streets looking for white butt to kick. While the movie sticks to the family's attempts to survive and escape, it's not too bad, especially in one harrowing rooftop escape scene. Wilson carries this part of the movie just fine. It's when an attempt is made to provide context or make statements that things fall apart. The reason for the native upset is concern over Western governments and corporations' alleged takeover of the country's water supply. We get a muddled explanation of events and how the West's behavior in general begets violence against it from Hammond, a vaguely franchised Western operative type played by Pierce Brosnan. But his being brought onto this project and then given a single-digit number of scenes and few lines represents one of the more shocking examples of poor character development you'll ever see. It's an attempt to turn the movie in a direction it's not prepared to go. Hard-hitting movies have been made about everything from the environment to conflict diamonds and have made a difference. Sadly, No Escape's attempt to explore the destructive nexus of corporate greed and Western government's corrupt machinations falls flat. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at take2moviereview.com and feed us back at youtube.com/take2moviereview.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
You're tuned correctly for the Open Mic Show. This hour of Open Mic being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. All right, I have to say, I apologize. Our last caller was so interesting that he qualifies and, in fact, should receive these 1986 baseball puzzle and cards from our friends at Kimball Tavern Antiques, corner of Salem and South Main Streets. if he's listening, if he can call back and give his address to our producer, Chris. Otherwise, we're going to try to call him back. But I think our listeners would agree. Very, very engaging conversation. Lots of good points. He wins these baseball cards and puzzle. So let's set that aside. If he calls back, otherwise Chris will call him by redial. If you're just joining us again, first caller to request it, free pass to not only the John Greenleaf Whittier Birthplace in Haverhill, but also the Whittier Home Museum in Amesbury. $5 value just for Whittier Birthplace alone. So free pass. Just call 978-374-1900 and request it. Come on the air, and we'll give you that. And then, of course, we're taking October birthdays and anniversaries each Monday this month. And the winner will receive a free 7-inch cake, choice of chocolate or vanilla, freshly baked by LBD's Second Generation Italian Bakery, 140 South Main Street in Bradford. We're really pleased that LBD's goes out of their way to provide these. And as I've said before, I'm so impressed that any business that can open at 6 a.m. every day, run all day long, and keep the public happy like they do. And what kind of baked good or sweet doesn't bring a smile to anyone's face? And if you're not necessarily looking for a cake, they have pastries, pies, desserts, and sweetbreads, specialty cakes, pizza, cookies, mini pastries, breads, you name it, LBD's Second Generation Italian Bakery. Okay, I will be taking more calls. Again, 978-374-1900. There's just a couple minutes before the news. So maybe what I'll do is tell you about some other things. As you may know, and I have not talked about enough, a new book, Snowbound with Zombies. Now, that might sound strange to you, but if you're a fan of horror, and actually a little bit of science fiction in this one, if I may stray a bit with my interpretation of what I've been reading, but Snowbound with Zombies is compiled and edited by David Gousewood, but it features major authors of the genre, Judy Calhoun, Roxanne Dent, Suzanne Dent, David and Scott Gousewood, John, McElveen, am I saying that right? David will call and correct me. Gregory Norris, Faye Ringel, Christy Peterson Schooner. But best-selling novelist Christopher Golden has contributed. Also local writer Tracy Carboni and Vermont folklorist Joseph Citro. Books are going to be available at this author's event Saturday, September 26th from 1 to 3 p.m. at Whittier Birthplace. Now, Saturday, September 26th is also the same day as, I believe, the chili cook-off at the Firefighting Museum, I believe, and River Ruckus. So if you plan your day correctly, get some, you know, start out early, get some chili at the Firefighting Museum on Canosa Avenue, the former Armory. Stop by Whittier Birthplace. Buy a book. You don't have to even buy the book, but I think they'd appreciate it. Take a look at the book. Meet the authors. Get an autograph. And then head down to River Ruckus. Make a day of it. And I will tell you that this event, Snowbound with Zombies, is going to be on the Trails and Sales calendar for the Essex National Heritage District. But David Gousewood kind of gave us a little overview. Whittier, beloved icon of pastoral poesy, is occasionally remembered as a fiery abolitionist or a crusading journalist, as well he should. But his first book was not a collection of his poetry, but an 1831 collection of local superstitions. And that's David Gousewood giving you the rationale for a book of this type. And you know, zombies are amazingly popular, and what a way to bring young people back into interest in our favorite son, local poet John Greenleaf Whittier. All right, we have a birthday call. We're going to try to squeeze that in before we go to the news. Perfect timing. You are on the Open Mic Show.
Hey, Tim.
Hi there. How are you?
In Bradford.
Very good. I'm glad to hear from you.
Yep, glad to hear Open Mic. I've been busy, but Thought I'd call in. I'd like to register my wife in the contest for the birthday cake.
Oh, what is your wife's name?
Joan.
Joan. I knew that, but I want listeners to know it. And so I want to make sure you didn't forget it.
I didn't forget it. I can't forget it, I'll tell you.
So happy birthday, Joan. What day is Joan's birthday?
October 10th.
October 10th, okay. So she has been entered into the contest for a free 7-inch cake from Albi D's second generation Italian bakery.
That's great.
All right, good. So everything else okay with you?
Everything else is fine, yep. Became a grandfather for the second time a week and a half ago.
Oh, that's right. I think I saw your Facebook post. Congratulations.
Yes, thank you. That was my daughter and her husband and their daughter, my granddaughter, and I have a grandson now, so that's very good. We went out to see him on Saturday, so it's very good. Life is good, Tim.
Good, and you're semi-retired now, is that right?
Sort of. I'm at home. I work at home about 40 hours a week.
Oh, 40. It's just you're down to 40.
45. I posted 44 last week.
Oh, that was just
I don't have to commute. I'm at home.
Oh, all right.
Sometimes I work at night, so yeah, I'm kind of riding the tide. So.
All right. Well, very good to hear from you.
Good to hear from you. Yeah.
All right.
I'll be in touch.
All right. Very good. And happy birthday, Joan. All right.
She can't hear you, but she's watching the ball game, but she can't hear you, but that's okay.
Well, at least you're loyal enough to us. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Have a good night, Ken.
You too. Bye-bye. Take care. Good night. All right. I wonder how many others are watching the ball game, but you know, we have baseball cards here. Can you get that watching another channel? So you call here. All right, let's take a break for local news with WHAV News Director Dana Esmol. He's going to tell you more about Merrimack Street, more about Greater Lawrence Family Health Care Center paying off its bills and yet still serving 55,000 patients. You're going to hear a lot more news, and then we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 8:03.
WHAV LP Haverhill. WHAV is a nonprofit community service of Public Media of New England, Incorporated.
Here's what's happening in local news. Groveland Police and a Federal Bureau of Investigations task force seek the public's help to identify a suspect in the robbery of a TD Bank branch Sunday morning in Groveland. According to Groveland Police Chief Robert J. Kermelowitz, a man walked into the TD Bank on Main Street, Groveland, at 11:37 a.m. Sunday, handed a note to a teller claiming he was armed with a gun and a knife and demanding money. The suspect fled southbound on School Street, Route 97, toward Georgetown with an undetermined amount of cash. No one was injured. Investigators have released surveillance photos of the robbery. The suspect is described as a black male, 20 to 30 years of age, approximately 5'11", weighing 160 to 170 pounds. He was wearing a blue Los Angeles Dodgers baseball cap with white letters and a white brim, a black hooded raincoat, blue jeans, sunglasses, and black and white tennis shoes. Anyone with information is urged to call the Groveland Police Department at 978-521-1212. All callers may remain anonymous. A weekend celebration of Haverhill's 375th anniversary, including free breakfast Sunday at Riverside Park, brought what organizers called, quote, light to, quote, good attendance levels and an estimated $21,000 net cost to taxpayers paid by a state grant. 375th Anniversary Committee Chairman and Haverhill Parks and Recreation Director Vincent Ouellette told WHAV Sunday the celebration, beginning with Thursday night's Haverhill Yesteryear Ball and ending with ethnic music performances Sunday, cost a total of up to $35,000. About $14,000 in fundraising by volunteers will be supplemented by about $21,000 from a $75,000 state grant obtained through the legislature by Representative Brian S. Dempsey, House Ways and Means Committee Chairman. A peak attendance level between 500 and 600 people came during Saturday evening's concerts and outdoor screening of the classic movie The Wizard of Oz, according to 375th Anniversary Committee member and Haverhill Historical Commission President Kerry Fitzgerald. In contrast, estimates of up to 350 people turned out Friday evening for a performance by Massachusetts native Ayla Brown. However, Willette added a children's activity tent was an event highlight bustling with activity.
The tent was filled up every hour on the hour, a lot of little kids enjoying themselves. The movie Wizard of Oz, there's a nice turnout for that, a lot of positive remarks. They never saw the movie quite that way. Friday night's event, you know, was basically, you know, probably 400 or 500 people here in a large venue. It doesn't look as impressive as a small venue, but it was a decent turnout. People, you know, we're a little disappointed that more people didn't show up for the quality of music that we had here. But it's a first-time event, and by the end of the night, we're quite pleased with the turnout. All in all, the venue was nice. It's something we can build upon and maybe look forward to doing something on a smaller scale in years to come.
An estimated total 150 people were served free breakfast by volunteers Sunday morning with scrambled eggs, bacon, and hash brown patty at a cost of about $300, with coffee and donuts donated by Heavenly Donuts, according to 375th Anniversary Committee member Peter A. Carboni, co-owner of Easy Way Cleaners. He told WHAV after an organizational meeting in July he fell ill and could not put that event together himself, as he had told the committee. He credited Steve DeMarcus of Mark's Deli for the menu selection and volunteers from the Crescent Yacht Club for cooking and serving. Mayor James J. Fiorentini, who attended the breakfast with his wife Martha and others, told WHAV, quote, "I think everything's great. They did a great job," end quote. For more in-depth coverage, visit WHAV.net. A healthcare organization without debt and one that still beats many national patient outcome averages is seemingly rare. The Greater Lawrence Family Health Center, however, reported just such findings last week. The nonprofit released its 2015 annual report last week before a crowd of supporters and donors at Andover Country Club. In addition, according to retiring president and chief executive officer Robin Angala, the group saved the healthcare system $58 million. Quality indicators show GLFHC patient outcomes beat national Medicaid plan averages in areas such as diabetes management, weight control, disease prevention, cervical cancer screenings, and controlled blood pressure. As an example, Chief Quality Officer Dean Cleghorn pointed to successes in controlling diabetes.
We know that close to 1,000 patients now are well controlled that were not in the past because of the kind of care that we've been able to manage and improve on over time.
Angala also reported GLFHC recorded a total of 55,000 patients during the last year, up from 25,000 when he began 14 years ago. According to data compiled in 2013 by the Massachusetts League of Community Health Centers, GLFHC generated $92 million in local economic activity, and its employees paid $13 million in state income taxes. Another achievement drew applause.
And this past year, we were fortunate enough to be able to liquidate all of our long-term debt, so we're now debt-free as an organization.
Greater Lawrence Family Health Center operates 5 primary care offices in Lawrence and 1 in Methuen. The group has previously discussed Haverhill expansion plans with city officials. In local high school sports, Whittier Tech Wildcats football and soccer action Monday afternoon. The boys junior varsity football team hosts Pentucket Regional High School, and boys varsity soccer is at home against Mystic Valley. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmill.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Rebecca Foster. Australia has a new prime minister following the ousting of Tony Abbott. Former communications minister Malcolm Turnbull has been elected leader of the Liberal Party in a late-night vote at Parliament House. Mr. Turnbull is generally considered less conservative than his predecessor and contrasts with Mr. Abbott in his stances on gay marriage and climate change. He will be the country's 4th prime minister since 2013. Egypt's prime minister has apologized after a dozen tourists were killed and another 10 sent to the hospital when Egyptian security forces mistook them for militants. Mexicans and Egyptians were among the victims. Egyptian officials say the holidaymakers were traveling in unmarked cars within a restricted zone in western Egypt when security forces opened fire. Andrea Arenas reports.
The tourist convoy of 4x4 vehicles had reportedly stopped for a barbecue when it was shelled by Egyptian army aircraft before troops opened fire from the ground. Mexico's foreign ministry said two of the victims and at least five of the injured were Mexican, but was still working on identifying the dead and wounded. A spokesperson for the Egyptian tourism ministry said the group did not have permits and did not inform authorities that they were heading to the area close to the border with Libya. Mexico's President Enrique Peña Nieto, who has demanded a full investigation, took to social media to condemn the attack.
Russia has positioned at least half a dozen tanks near a strategic airfield in Syria, according to Reuters reports. U.S. officials say the area where the T-90 battle tanks were seen is a stronghold for Syria's Bashar al-Assad regime, long supported by its Russian ally during the ongoing civil war. Kevin McAleese reports from Washington.
A Pentagon spokesman said the U.S. is closely monitoring the buildup, but stopped short of exact details about the numbers of Russian military personnel and hardware being flown to Latakia on the Syrian coast. The U.S. is concerned that Russia's military forces could potentially come into contact with the U.S. air campaign against ISIS in Syria. Speaking at the U.S. State Department, John Kirby said the U.S. position hasn't changed.
While we would welcome, and I said this last week, a constructive Russian role in countering ISIL, it can't include direct support to the Assad regime.
President Obama has already warned Moscow that doubling down on its long-standing support of the Assad regime would be a big mistake.
U.S. law enforcement anticipates it will be filing additional charges in the expanding FIFA scandal. U.S. Attorney General Loretta Lynch told reporters that the American investigation is continuing and getting broader. From bureaus worldwide, this is FSN.
Wave weather.
I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre with wave weather. We'll head through the nighttime hours with mostly clear skies at a low temperature bottoming out somewhere in the mid-50s. Great weather for the rest of the work week. Strong high pressure in place. Mostly sunny on Tuesday with a high right around or maybe a little above 80. All clear Tuesday night. Low settling back to 60. Sunny on Wednesday with a high near 80 and mostly sunny Thursday and Friday and highs both days somewhere between 80 and 85 degrees. I'm WHAV meteorologist Rob St. Pierre. Your next wave weather in 30 minutes.
This is Pacifica Radio for the Merrimack Valley. WHAV. This is listener-supported community radio, WHAV LP Hoover, the Merrimack Valley's Pacifica affiliate.
WHAV Merrimack Valley. Open mic!
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco at whav.net.
This is Tim Coco, and you're tuned to the Open Mic Show. Special thanks to Chris in Master Control. He's taking your calls and forwarding them on to me. So still time to call. Open lines, 978-374-1900. And I still have left as a gift for any special caller 15 bubblegum cards and one stick of bubblegum from 1988. I don't recommend you chewing the gum, but it's in the original packaging, still completely wrapped, from our friends at Kimball Tavern Antiques, corner of Salem and South Main Streets in Bradford. So Apparently, the contest that's on these Topps baseball cards, win a trip to the 1989 spring training, probably is void, unless you have a time machine. But also, you can wish someone a happy birthday or a couple a happy anniversary, and their name will be placed into the hat to win a free 7-inch cake from LBD's second-generation Italian bakery on 140 South Main Street in Bradford. And the prizes continue. You can get a free pass to visit Whittier Birthplace, 305 Whittier Road, right here in Haverhill. It's the birthplace of the famous poet, John Greenleaf Whittier. But special, if you get this free admission pass, you'll also be able to go absolutely free of charge to the Whittier Home Museum, 86 Friend Street in Amesbury. Just be the first person to ask for it, and we can do that. Okay, a couple of things before we take a brief break for Community Spotlight. There are a number of topics you could call about. Were you stuck in the traffic jam on 495, and how does that make you feel? Were you late for work? Is it fair? What is the problem? Is the State Department of Transportation inadequate, or is it just, well, there's nothing you can do about it? I don't know. I wonder sometimes. Now, of course, Merrimack Street's in the news. City considering, City Council will kind of give the go-ahead tomorrow night or not, looking at taking 60 Merrimack Street by eminent domain. That means taking it away from the owner, getting an appraisal, which is what the council is going to pay for if they approve it, getting an appraisal of the building, and then giving the owner that much money. Now, we think maybe the owner paid too much for the building at the top of the last real estate market, and so maybe they're not really ready to sell because the prices won't be right. What recourse will that will those owners have? Maybe they secretly welcome it. It solves a lot of problems, perhaps. They don't have to go through the trouble of having the side of their building repaired that was damaged during the demolition of the other ones. Maybe. All right, another topic you might want to talk about is, did you go to the 375th Haverhill anniversary kickoff events, the yesteryear ball or music by the river on Friday or the family festival on Saturday or the multicultural festival and free breakfast, let's not forget about free breakfast, on Sunday. If you didn't, is there a story there that you want to share? Our caller earlier pointed out that maybe shuttle buses to help bring in both seniors that might otherwise have no transportation, or maybe even younger kids who otherwise can't get to these events might have benefited from some type of a shuttle bus. I wonder what you might think of that. A news item, Pawtucket Bank is going to have trouble taking care of you downtown beginning Wednesday and for a month, according to this information from the bank. They're going to suggest other ways that you can do your banking, including, I imagine, the upper deck of the parking garage or one of their other branches. Now, Pawtucket, I don't think they're upset about this because they bought the naming rights to Harbor Place. It's actually going to be called Pawtucket Bank Plaza, and they're going to put their corporate offices on one floor of the new building. So they probably just see it as a necessary evil. What do you think of that? Then, of course, Tattersall Farm Day is this Sunday. WHAB will be there with a table. We welcome you. Oh, matter of fact, Chris, you have some photos of Tattersall Farm Farm Day. This is from Tattersall Farm's website, and maybe you don't even know what's going on there, but it's a couple of teachers, you may have had them in high school yourself, the Tattersall sisters, gave the farm to the city of Haverhill. And it's quite a place, and getting ready for the harvest season, Tattersall Farm Day on Sunday is certainly something you want to consider putting on your calendar. So think about that as well. And couple of other minor topics you might want to talk about. We had a caller talk earlier, I think it was Jerry, you know, about our focus seems to be on imprisoning drug addicts and people with really their mental health problems, as opposed to providing them some care and services. And you might say, well, you know, I believe in harsh penalties, but consider this. Many of the prisons in the United States are now privately owned, and some of those prison owners have lobbyists who go to Washington and try to get laws passed to ensure that those private prisons will be filled. What do you think of that? Maybe you have a comment. And maybe an historical topic. David Goudswood, Open Mic Show historian, who of course is editing the new book Snowbound with Zombies, is alerted me to something in the last few weeks, and see if my memory serves me properly. But Howe Street in downtown Haverhill, where WHAV's former building is, Howe Street, he believes was named for and this is where he can correct me, the owner of the Haverhill's private waterworks at the time. So these streets all have a history if we can only track them all down. Let's take a brief break for Community Spotlight, and then let's try to work in one or two more calls.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
If you want to know what's going on at WHAV, sign up for the free monthly Wavelengths newsletter online at whav.net.
Catch the wave!
Hi, I'm meteorologist Gary Best. Do you need to know if it's going to be hot or cold, wet or dry? Well, find out every half hour, 7 days a week with Wave Weather. I'll keep you in touch with up-to-the-minute reports covering the greater Merrimack Valley and beyond. It's WHAV for accurate weather when you want it.
Community Spotlight!
Haverhill Council on Aging is planning a trip to Symphony Hall for a Boston Symphony Orchestra morning rehearsal performance, Thursday, October 8th. The bus departs at 9 a.m. from the Haverhill Department of Public Works, 500 Primrose Street. The cost of the trip is $45 per person. For more information, call 978-374-2390. Someone you know is on WHAV. Submit or read your own nonprofit announcements, click on the contact tab at whav.net or email news at whav.net. In the Edwin V. Johnson newsroom, this is Maddie Karen.
WHAV Open Mic!
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Being brought to you by the Merrimack Valley Economic Development Council. Smart companies choose the Merrimack Valley. Let's go to the phones. You are on the Open Mic Show.
How are you?
Hi there. How are you?
Not too bad.
Hey, we're using gifts from Kimball Tavern Antiques to encourage callers tonight, and it's working.
That's good. I'd just like to say that the gentleman that called, well, I've never heard him. I recognize his voice. He has some good points.
I was very, very pleased to hear from him. Made excellent points.
He did. I hope he keeps calling. I really, you know, we have a lot of musical talent come out of Haverhill. And actually...
You've heard me with the gazoo.
Well, yeah. But actually, you know, I grew up with a drummer. He was a drummer for the John Mayall and the Blues Breakers. You go to John Mayall.
Okay.
This was a guy from 11th Ave. I can say his name. Joey Uli.
Okay.
He grew up on 11th Ave. I mean, a lot of talent come out of Haverhill. And I know these guys, they're tight. I've seen them in EJ. But, you know, we really, in Haverhill, we just don't know how to, highlight, to show this stuff. I understand we don't have anywhere to perform in Haverhill, any good-sized bands to perform. Where are they going to perform? You know, I'm just going to say this. The Newburyport had the River Fest put on by, you know, somebody.
That's right. That's okay. Right.
And the top headliner was the English Beat. And I know it's a different city, but they drew 20,000 people.
Now, you know what's funny?
On a Saturday.
Actually, help refresh my memory. Didn't we have some big acts at the stadium, but there were some concerns, and then they were not allowed there anymore?
I know Jay Giles was in the stadium, played one time.
Jay Giles band, that was a big one.
Yeah, but that was without, I don't believe Peter Wolf was there. But we really don't have any place in Haverhill to, even the River. Lowell has a great venue. For a lot of bands.
You're right.
You can see it all somewhere in the papers. People, the John Hyatt.
Do you remember, I think it was Mayor Rorak that tried to get a convention center built downtown that would actually use what the air rights over the parking garage.
We just haven't done it. We haven't utilized the river. We still haven't. It's been Newburyport does, Lowell does. Lawrence, that's a different state. So,
okay.
It's really sad that this was our 375th anniversary for the city. And I'm not blaming the people that promoted this thing. I just think it was the way Haverhill is, and it has been for years.
Okay, now when you say the way it is, do you mean apathetic? What do you mean?
We don't promote it. We don't promote Haverhill too. I don't think we promote it. But you remember the last big one we had, when we had a big parade and they come, when we had a downtown and we had that big parade, I think it was in the 60s maybe. Do you remember that?
I don't know.
It was an anniversary for the city.
There were several. There was the 320... fifth maybe. Anniversary, maybe. But there was also one in 1970 for the 100th anniversary of being a city.
Do you know what they do down at what Topsfield Fair? The bus company I work for, we shuttle bus people up and down Route 1. One day we shuttle bus them. And he had a good point. We don't have any. I'm not blaming anybody, but. We have to get people to come to Haverhill, number one. I don't know why. There's no attraction.
Yeah, I it's a very good point. I think part of it is that we used to have, frankly, more people in our recreation department. Poor Vinnie Ouellette pretty much does it by himself.
Vinnie does a great job.
He does it almost by himself.
That's right, he does.
I guess it's an argument you have to make. Okay, well, do we add a couple people here? Maybe one could write some grants. Another could work on some of these promotional items. But then you're going to say, well, gee, why don't we use that money instead to hire another firefighter or another teacher?
There was a lot of talent down there. I'm not saying I didn't go, but I know there's a lot of talent. We have talent that comes to the Bradford Common.
Well, one
in the summertime.
I don't know if you heard during when I had guests on from the Haverhill 375 committee a couple of weeks ago on this show. It was our attempt to help promote it. And I think there was kind of a widespread regret that maybe not enough volunteers came forward to help organize it, again, leaving it almost all to Vinny and Kerry Fitzgerald. And,
yeah.
I understand also behind the scenes there was a key player who was stricken with an illness. And so, but I know what you're saying.
Yeah, it's just, it seems like it should have been 375. Or maybe in 25 years, or 400 a year, we'll have a big one.
Well,
you
know,
still, Tim, if we're still here.
Well, that's true. Well, you know, there's still some events coming up. That's why I was really pleased to hear that call. Or maybe it's not too late to turn the New Year's celebration into, like, the biggest thing ever.
Yeah, it could be. Anyway, I just want to... I hope that gentleman calls. I really... you know, he's got some... Like the bridge. You know, I understand the bridge.
No,
we really need to utilize the river in Haverhill. If Haverhill wants to go anywhere, you have to utilize that river.
No, it's really our strongest asset. I'd say probably second place is 495.
Well, you just went off on the TV, so.
Yeah, I noticed that.
my phone's going to go dead.
All right. Well, thank you very much for your call.
Thanks for advertising for Kimball. We appreciate it.
We appreciate the gifts. Thank you.
I'll be around.
Take care.
We're not going nowhere. Hey, Timmy.
Yes.
One thing about Kimball Tavern, we don't charge. Come on over and look at the second oldest house in Haverhill. Come on over and take a look at it.
All right, thanks for that.
It's a beautiful house.
It really is. Thank you very much for that.
Bye-bye.
And all that you do. All right, thank you very much. That'll do it for the Open Mic Show. Lots of topics. We really didn't get too much more to go on. We ran out of time, but feel free to call next week, and then we will be back then with a whole lot more, some special guests, and of course, Chris at the controls in Master Control. Good night.
Open Mic!
Join Tim Coco live on the Open Mic again next Monday night at 6:30. The opinions expressed on the Open Mic Show are not necessarily those of WHAV, its underwriters, or affiliated stations. The Open Mic Show came to you from the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom.